Kairos also, no. Okay, so as a result of the abandonment of God, people actually their morality has become so degenerate, it became so decayed that it resulted on so many sins that were mentioned in the book of Romans in chapter 1, no. And because of that, the audience of Paul probably thought, because these people are Gentiles, they are pagans, and they have committed this sin, they are the ones who only would suffer penalty. And in chapter 2, actually, Paul is addressing and trying to address a certain type of audience, which he is talking about what this judgment is happening. There is a chapter 1. However, because of that kind of thinking that these people are thinking about these pagans and these Gentile people that are committing this sin, Paul is trying to catch them also and saying na ayaw mo pagdahom na because nagbuhat sila ana na amoy excuse, but because of the things that you have done also, even if you pass judgment on them, wala mo excuse, you are also condemning yourself. So verse 1 is saying here that therefore you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges, for in passing judgment on another you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same thing, no. So before we go on, I would like to bring you to a brief survey of the judgment of God in the Bible, no. So let's go over some of the judgment that are mentioned in the Old Testament as well as in the New Testament, no. So in the Old Testament judgment, we see that God judged the judgment of Satan and the fallen angels, no. In the book of Ezekiel, we see that passage. Number 2, we also have this judgment on the Garden of Eden. In Genesis 3, when Eve committed eating that tree, no, and then Adam also ate it. So they were judged. They were kinagipahawa sila sa Garden of Eden. Number 3, there's also the judgment on covenant and fidelity. When God entered into a covenant with Israel, actually there's an associated kinang blessings and curses that is carried or kinang gipakapin ana nga covenant, no. So when they obey with the covenant, they will have enjoy blessings, they will enjoy peace. But if they would disobey and kinang dili sila mutuo sa covenant, they would also incur curses and kinang mga penalty, no. There's also judgment to moral degeneration, which is what we have seen in chapter 1, no. God abandoned them because of their sins. And we also have this judgment of Christ for the sin of the world. You can see this in Isaiah 53, when Christ is prophesied to take on the judgment of people upon himself. So that's some of the pictures of judgment that we can see in the Old Testament. Now judgment that we can see in the New Testament, no. If you are familiar with the last judgment or kinang the last day, we can see the picture of judgment as kinang separation of kinang good and evil, the judgment which we call as separation of people in the last day. So we picture the judgment as kinang separation of goat from the sheep, no. Ilain na siya, the goat is on the right side and the sheep is on the left. The goat is on the left and then the sheep is on the right. We also see the picture of separation between the wheat and the tares, no. In the field, when the harvest comes, they would separate the tares, katong dili dili siya. These are the plants that doesn't bring the fruit as the wheat does. So giseparate pud ang kanang tares from the wheat. Secondly, we also have this picture of judgment as kanang judgment of all men, no. When Paul came to Areopagus in Greece, he was actually preaching to them that a time will come when God will judge them of their action. That's why he said nga, God is calling everyone everywhere to repent, because there is an appointed time that God would judge all men by a man he called Jesus Christ. Number three, the picture of judgment in the New Testament is inescapable. Meaning, wala gyoy makawala ani. Why? Because even every careless word is judged. Na kay kinang gisulti diha nga kuan na it's a careless somehow para nimo murag innocent na siya, but for that word you are already judged, because in Matthew 12:36 even careless word will be judged. So wala tay escape, everyone would be judged. Another picture kind of judgment that we see in the New Testament is judgment according to works, no? So we see Jesus as a judge, and then he would say he will judge these people because of what he has done. And in the book of Revelations, we see that God is judging people for what they have done in their lives. So this is a judgment according to works. We have also the great white throne. I think you're familiar with this in Revelations chapter 20, that there was the great white throne, and all the souls, all the people that are resurrected, and then every one of them is judged by Christ. And lastly, in the New Testament, it was Jesus Christ who is pictured as the judge. No? When Christ came for the first time, he came actually as a savior to give repentance and eternal life to those who believe in him. The second time that he comes here, he would no longer come as a savior, but he will come as a judge. So let's go on. Now, so with that, I would like to give you some principles or things that governs God's judgment. No, if we look at the passage of in verse 1 to 16, there are actually six things that governs God in judging people. One is that God judges based on knowledge. No, therefore you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges. For in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things. No, so the audience that Paul is saying here is that they were actually passing judgment. Ilang gihukman ang katong tao nga nagcommit atong sala nga gimention ni Paul in chapter 1. However, in passing that judgment, there's actually a presupposition that they know what is right and what is wrong. In passing those judgments sa katong tao, gimention ni Paul in chapter 1, there's actually a moral framework na ilang gibasihan to judge why what they are saying is actually wrong. So because of that, they knew themselves that katong ilang sayop ng buhat, sayop to siya, sala to sa Ginoo. The thing here is that they themselves are the ones doing it also. That is why, because of that knowledge, God will also judge them for that. No? So these people, the people that wherein Paul actually mentioned in the later part of the chapter as the Jews or the moralist, no, and they call themselves kinang mga moral Jews, no. They think that in passing judgment, they have elevated themselves. Mura ba gipataas nila nga, pati kay ka makasalanan ka, so ako mismo nga nag-judge ko. I am free, or I am elevating myself. Nadili ko parihan ninyo. However, Paul is quite adamant you are so conceited that because of what you think that you are not, but because you did that, you are also so hypocrite that what you are showing is not what you are really. Meaning you show that you are blameless and you are sinless. But your actions actually judge you because you did this, not necessarily in public, but also in secret. No? So you cannot excuse yourself, because the knowledge that you have what is right and wrong is the one that will judge you later when you committed these things that God prohibits. So Jesus actually taught in Matthew 7 that says, judge not that you not be judged, no? For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? So meaning, if you judge somebody, be sure that wala kay anak kumuhang guilt na makuha mo. So actually, Paul in verse 1 is saying, God did not condemn these Jews because of passing judgment, but he condemned them because in passing that judgment, they are the ones condemning themselves, kasi sila po mismo ang nagbuhat anak. It's what they did that condemns them, not necessarily because of that passing of judgment. Number two, principle that governs God's judgment is God's judgment is based on truth. Okay, so verse 2, it says here that that we know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. No, so other translation, actually, let's take a look at the New King James Version. It says here that, but we know that the judgment of God is according to truth against those who practice such things. God's truth is actually the perfect standard for judging men. No, it's like when you collect a rent from your tenant, there is a basis why you collect that kind of amount, because that is what is written in the contract. So kung may hanggang contract is 5,000 a month, if you as a landlord at the end of the month, you collected 5,000 because that is what is stated in the contract. That is what is being agreed as true for both of you, no? So God judges based on what is true, and it is true that God will punish the degenerate, no? But it's also equally true that he will punish the moralist, no? It's Jesus Christ actually elevated the standard of the law by saying that you are not judged only because you do these things, but even if it is still napanasin mong heart, you will be judged already because you have already committed that sin in your heart. Wala pa lang na siya ipanganak. Meaning, nabuntis pa lang na sa iyong kasing-kasing sa iyong muna-huna, pero naana na siya ngasala, nga sala, mo, nga ano na siya, mugawasa na siya later on. Okay? let us say, for example, if you caught somebody that is being apprehended for a traffic violation, nga, nagdadagan siya 100 kilometers per hour. Dito, gidakop siya. And you yourself thinks na dili ka maapil ana. But you're also running at 80 kilometers per hour. So you think na siya wala siya appeal kay ka 100 kilometers per hour man. Pero what he does not know is that the allowed speed is only 60 kilometers per hour. So those things that is revealed by God, either by nature or by scripture, is actually the basis for how he judges the actions of man. So God judges according to truth. If you think that a sin is lighter kay na siya, gaandra kay na siya, para nimo nya bugat kini sa katao, you think that he only incur the penalty of his action, but ikaw kay nagtuo ka nga gamay ra kay nang imuha, basi dag excuse ka. But no, the truth is God will punish sin regardless of how small, how big it is. No, so that's a little bit scary and makulbaan jud ka. No? So we go on. If we bring that truth home in our situation or in our society, especially karong hapit ng election, we keep on looking at the lives of the candidates na atong ma-encounter or atong mabasa sa news, and especially for men, kanang tawhana na daghan man nag-uyab, daghan man nagkabit, nga nung mubutar man ko ana, kabati anong tawhana. But if you know the truth, when Jesus Christ say nga, even if you look a woman lustfully in your heart, you also committed the same kind of sin that this person is committing blatantly in public. So truth is the one that should be based, not the actions of men or not the opinions of other people regarding a certain type of act. Third, God's judgment is God's judgment presume man's guilt, no? Verse 3 to 5. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things and yet do them yourselves, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? No? So, Paul is saying that ganina, wala kay excuse. kay gibuhat ni mo pareha po sa ilang gibuhat. Now, ito niya, wala kay escape. Because bisag unsa kagamay sa imuhang sa imong gibuhat na sala, wala kay escape sa judgment. So no excuse, at the same time, no escape. So wagi maka lingkawas pag abot na sa panahon sa paghukom, kay nga no ang tanan hukman man, and God presume that because of that kind of verdict, you are actually guilty of what you have done, not just in passing judgment on them, but also in committing the sins, the venial or the smaller kind of sins that you do in your life, no? But in verse 4 actually, Paul is actually introducing a kind of aspect of God's character, no? Nga despite a series of kinang indictments nga iyang gi-indict ni mga tawhan nga muni ang sala ninyo, muni ang inyong gibuhat. Yet Paul is saying nga even if you practice these things, God is also kind. In that he is a God who exercises forbearance and patience. What's the meaning forbearance? No? Forbearance is a kind of attitude nga kinang kung sa Bisaya pa na siya mapailubon. No? Taas kay sag pailob. It's not a picture of somebody nga suko kay siya pero nagpugong lang siya and then later on parusahan ka or kinang no, so this is not the kind of forbearance God is, no? It is not the kind of forbearance or kinang picture nga like for example a father nga niadto sa mall unya nagbinadlo yang anak, suko na kay siya pero gipugngan lagi niya kay daghan kay tao, unya lang ka inig paulit nimo, no? That's not the kind of patience that Paul is saying here when he say that God is kinang kind in his forbearance and patience. But the kind of forbearance that Paul described God is that it is a form of kinang patience bitaw. He tries to restrain himself out of compassion. Dili nang kinang iyang gipugnan lang kay suko na kay siya nag-urus-urus na gid ang iyang kwan. Dili mo na, because God's forbearance and patience is actually born out of his mercy and love for sinful people. So, says here nga kwan, do not suppose that the riches of his kindness imo na siyang ipasagdan or kinang do not presume, or meaning ayaw na siya panamastamasi. Ayaw na i-underestimate. Nga because God is so kind in being patient with you, in other words, he also used the word long-suffering, may nantuson ang Ginoo. Do not consider that as a weakness on God's part. Do not presume it, do not underestimate it, because that forbearance of patience is meant for you to repent and mend your ways. So, although God is a judge, judging God na siya, no? He's actually fierce when he executes his judgment. And we heard that ganina, when he abandoned people, actually, worse kaya ang mabot. But there's also another side of God's character. ng out of His compassion and His pity for other for sinful people, He is actually patient with them. And we are actually a recipient for that. No? God is so patient with us nga, nakakumit kag sin diha, walay paka diretso, no? Kabantay mo, ana? Nga, if you committed a sin, you did not receive the judgment right away or the penalty. So why ko nag ato dito sa kwan? Aso sa puente ko, no? Cross ko nag red light. Diba diretso na yun ka? Takpo na yun ka? But God is not. He exercises patience and patience to people who committed sins, because he doesn't actually enjoy when he punishes people. The book of Jeremiah or Ezekiel, he doesn't enjoy. But his patience is actually giving you the chance to mend your ways and to repent of your sin. But the audience in Paul's time is not. And in verse 5, it says, "But because of your hard and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed." So, if that patience and forbearance of God does not affect you, or does not in some way, nakausab sa imong huna-huna, imo ng fault, it's because Paul is saying, ikaw ra mismo nagtigom sa mga sa kinang paghukom. Ikaw rin nagtigom, or you are storing up for yourself the wrath that is ready for the day of judgment. In the day of judgment, you are the ones who are collecting that kind of penalty. Ikaw rin ang nagbutang ana sa imong alkansiya. So that in the time of judgment, God will open up the wrath. This is what you have done. No? So God's judgment, no, number 3, presume man's guilt, no? So God is God is patient, God is God is long suffering, God is he has this character of forbearance, and this is actually beautifully shown when Jesus Christ did when he raised Jerusalem before that time of his crucifixion. He wept over Jerusalem and he said, "Oh Jerusalem, Jerusalem." Matthew 23:37, "The city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it, how often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gather her brood under her wings." Take a look at that kind of picture, no? Despite the sinfulness that man committed in all of his life, in all of his days, yet Jesus Christ is saying, God is like a hen would like to gather these chicks under her wings. Number 4, God judges based on their deeds. No, verse 6, "He will render to each one according to his works. To those who by patience will doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, He will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. There will be tribulation and distress for every human being who does evil, the Jew first and also the Greek. But glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good, the Jew first, also the Greek." So, the audience of Paul thought that because they possessed the law and because they were given a special privilege because God entrusted to them a set of instructions or kinang principles that they have to live throughout their lives, they think that they are already enjoying a certain privilege nga dili sila maapil sa paghukom. However, the passage actually says nga God judges people not based on their status, no, or ilang race, ilang origin, but God will judge based on what they have done. No? For those who are seeking glory and honor and immortality, He will give eternal life. Disobedient or unrighteous ka, wrath and fury in the future. But at the same time, in the present, imong si Paul na there is a tribulation and distress. So, when you actually committed sin in your life, when you know in your conscience that you have committed wrong, it actually creates distress. What if mo ni mahitabo? What if mo ni ano masakpan niya ko? What if akong gibuhat may balaan niya later on? No, there's a distress and there's a tribulation that ano, that everybody will experience in this life, but not only that, in the future. Paul is saying, "My wrath and fury." And this brings to the question ko, no, what would happen katong wala nakahear sa gospel? Unsa may mahitabo nila? Will they be judged because somebody failed to ano to do mission work and then preach to them the gospel of ano, the gospel of salvation? Unsa may mahitabo? No? It says here na they are judged not because they did not hear the gospel or kanang usay ilang nadunggan, but because of what they have done. In chapter 1, we see that ano that God actually revealed himself already, no, in nature, the glory of his creation. Those are the kind of ano of knowledge that would ano that would be as a basis when God judges them, even if wala pa sila nakadungog sa gospel. So judgment is based on deeds. Klaro kayo. Kung nakikibuhat nga maayo, okay reward. Kung yung magibuhat is evil and righteous, naki punishment. Which brings us to kenang observations bitaw nga God will also judge even if a person goes to church and profess faith. So meaning even if a person is ano is kinang nag-profess siya nga I believe in Christ, I trust in God in salvation.